As I was preparing this week for this message, I just began to really come to an understanding that we really don't know as a body how much God loves us. That we're limited in our understanding of the love of God that He has for us. So limited that we fall back into our nature, an old nature, in ways in which we express that love that God has for us. We express that toward others, and it comes out of a place where it shouldn't. And that's not saying that you do anything bad. That's not saying that you say anything bad or anything like that. But I just believe that a lot of times we respond, at least is what I've been sensing this week, that we respond from a place that is really tied up in our emotions. God gives us emotions, hope and love and trust and those things. God gives us emotions, but He doesn't want us to be governed by them. He gives us His word for a reason. And we respond to it so that we can walk in His way. So that we can delight in His word. So that we can benefit from what He has given to us in this life. And I just want us to think about the love of God and how it's so far beyond and so greater than what we can imagine or what we can even think. And if we can ever get a real understanding of that love and that mercy and grace, that it would change how we respond to Him. It would change how we love one another. It'll change our prayer life. It would change our word life. It would change what we do day to day, minute by minute. What we set our minds on. Amen? I want to talk to you today about a message title. We're still in the series about discipleship, but it's called God is Greater Than, or Love is Greater Than. Because the Word says that God is love. Amen? So when you say love, what we're really saying is God. So how I prefaced that earlier, in comparison, we want to make sure that the love that we say that we're loving people in, when it comes to loving people, how God has led us to love them, that is congruent with His nature and not just the nature of man. That there's not this dichotomy that people see us love one way and they say, is that the way that God loves? You are Christian? Amen? I pray these things today, that the Word of God would be compelling. Compelling to draw you from the place that you are to the place that God would want you to be. I pray, secondly, that the Word of God would be compassionate. That it would be with passion, His love for you. That it would be kind. That it would be considerate. That it would be thoughtful about how the word is ministered to your heart this morning. That it doesn't push you off, but it draws you close to Him. I pray third, that the word of God would be convicting. That there would be conviction on the speaker, myself this morning, by the power of the Holy Spirit. But that the Holy Spirit would convict your hearts this morning. Amen? And I pray, as I stated earlier, that the word of God would be congruent with our lives and what He says for us. Amen. Discipleship, love is greater than. John 3:16, we all know that verse. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in Him would not perish, but have eternal life. We love that verse. Because we're included in that verse. Amen. Those who have accepted Jesus, that's probably the verse that we ran to. Amen. It's the most quoted verse, most seen, most visible, most known verse in all the world. Is that particular verse right there. That God would send His only begotten Son. and give him as a sacrifice for all mankind. Amen. That's a good God. That's the love of God. 1 John 4:8 says, anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. Later on down in that same chapter in verse 18, it says, there is no fear in love, but perfect love cast out all fear. I don't know about you, but I don't love perfectly. But I have been loved perfectly. And because I have been loved perfectly, he is working in me to perfect me to him. To perfect me in him. So although we don't always love perfectly, we can be loved by someone who is perfect and has a perfect love for us and has a measuring stick, somehow a standard that we can look to in the Word that says this is how he loves. So I want to love like that. Amen? See, love is greater than anything that we have in this life. Love is greater than our voices that are around us. Love is greater than the circumstances that we're facing. Love is greater than the loudest, the most obvious thing in our lives that is in direct opposition to what God is trying to do in us. Love is greater than that thing. And what I want to show you here in a word, because when I say this next sentence, I want you to understand that I'm not talking about a group per se, but I am talking about a way in which people live, a way and a manner in which we live in our world. And that is, love is greater than the crowd. There's pressure in the crowd. There's influence in the crowd. There's noise in the crowd. There's even movement in the crowd. But love is greater than the crowd. Oftentimes, you can feel lost in the crowd. You can feel in the midst of the crowd, all the things are going around me. How many of you know people can have great anxiety in the middle of a crowd? Because there's great insecurity in who I am. And if I'm in this crowd, I'm lost and no one sees me. All they see is the crowd. So Father, see me. His love is great enough to see you because his love is greater than the crowd. See, in the age of retweets, likes, thumbs up, shares, we can lose sight of the power of a personal revelation of who God is. We can lose sight of a personal understanding and relationship that exposes our hearts and makes us authentically vulnerable. Why? Because we're focused on an image. Because we're focused on what we're projecting to others. Because we're focused on what others might see. How many of you have been in that place? I don't want to show everything going on because people might see and they might think differently of me. Amen? It's no different than, you know, being in your bathroom and your kid opens the door and you're coming out of the shower like, pull the door, right? You don't want to be exposed and you're most vulnerable when you're most vulnerable. You want to keep some element protected. But can I tell you this? God's desire is that there be nothing that stands between our heart and him. That we would be naked and unashamed before God. Not like Adam and Eve were after the fall, but as believers are after Jesus Christ rose from the dead. Amen? That is his desire, is that there be no division, no wall between us. You see, love is greater than your image, no matter how great it is or how ugly it is. No matter how tall, charming, dark, handsome you may be, no matter how small, frumpy, it doesn't matter. It's greater. God's love is greater than our image. You know why? Because you are fearfully and wonderfully made. He's created you. See, the way people see you impacts how you see yourself. The love of God covers a multitude of sin. That is important because oftentimes when we see ourselves through our problems, through our pain, through our past. But we have to know that God loves us so much that it covers our sins. It covers those things that we have identified with, and now we can identify with Him. Amen? Today, image is more valued than what's honest. The projected image, the created image, is more valued than what's honest. Amen? Let me give you an example. If it wasn't that, why would we have the need for poles? Because we are concerned about what the crowd says. And whatever the crowd says is what we decide to do. Can I tell you that love is greater than the crowd? And that God's desire is not that we move by what the crowd says, but by what His Word says. Amen? There are a lot of efforts that go into creating an image that's desirable and one that gets instant feedback, thumbs up and expressions, emojis and comments. Whatever happened to owning what we've done wrong? Whatever happened to owning our own failures, our own mistakes? Whatever happened to saying, I made a mess, and Father, help me clean it up? This covering, this polling, this keeping someone else from seeing issues is not the way of God. It's the way of the world. To be more concerned about how people see you rather than how God sees you. Luke 16:15 says, this is the word of God. He said to them, you are the ones, speaking to the Pharisees, who justify yourselves in the eyes of others, the crowd. But God knows your hearts. What people value highly is detestable in God's sight. See, the more comfortable we become with lying to ourselves, convincing ourselves that we're okay, the more we lie to others. And the more we lie to others, ultimately, the more we lie to God. The problem is that when you've lied so much, you don't know where the truth begins and the lie ends. There becomes this blurredness. You don't know where God begins and you end. You don't know with what you said and what God said because it's all been mixed up together. Here's why. Because you have come to a place where your conscience has been seared. You've come to a place where your heart has been pain, so much that it begins to scar and begins to callous and you don't feel the prick of God anymore. The prick of the Holy Spirit that says, no. Don't go there. Or slow down. Look to them. There's a quote that says, it's lies. It's all lies. Some of them are just prettier than others. That's all. People see what they think is there. It's lies. It's lies. It's all lies. Some of them are just prettier than others. That's all. People see what they think is there. Can you say you've been in that place before where you've looked at things and you go, man, once again, someone has messed up and I've been duped in believing that something was authentic about them and it wasn't. Amen? I've been duped myself, deceived myself into thinking that I was doing that out of the kindness of my heart when actually there was an agenda in my own heart. See, we're either being perfected in the love of Christ or we're conforming to this world. You're either moving toward Christ or you're remaining in the world. The enemy wants you to value saving your face rather than humbling yourself. The enemy wants you to cover yourself in the things. He's always desired that. That is Adam and Eve in the garden. Cover yourself. Blend in. You seen that meme where the Simpsons, Homer is backing into the bushes. Oof, I don't said something I shouldn't have said. You know, I've done something I shouldn't have done. I've acted the way I shouldn't have acted, right? And I've put my foot in my mouth. I've done something, and I'm trying to blend into the things around me. God is greater. His love is greater than the crowd. The word tells us to be aware of Satan's devices in 2 Corinthians 2:11. I want to talk to you. Two or three things real quick, and we're going to go through them. And I want to show you an example of God's love being greater than the crowd. Luke 5, chapter 1 through 11, let's read this. It says, on one occasion while the crowd was pressing in, there's a crowd, pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he was standing by the lake Gennesaret. I'm not saying that right, but we'll go on. And he saw two boats by the lake, but the fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. Again, the fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. No one were in the boats. Getting into one of the boats was Simon's, which was Simon's. He asked him to put out a little from the land, and he sat down and taught the people from the boat. So he sat down in the boat and he addressed the crowd. And when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, put out to the deep and let down your nets for a catch. And Simon answered, Master, we toiled all night and we took nothing. But at your word, I will let down the nets. And when he had done this, they enclosed a large number of fish and their nets were breaking. They signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and to help them. And they came and they filled both the boats so that they began to sink. And when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at his knees, at Jesus' knees, saying, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. For he and all who were with them were astonished at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching men. And when they had brought their boats to the land, they left everything and followed him. We're familiar with that passage. Peter, in this passage, has a personal revelation of his own heart. He sees himself in the light of the glory of Jesus, and he knows where he is. He knows that this man is holy, and I'm not. He sees and he realizes that Jesus had the power over the nature, over creation, over everything. And after all, it was at his word and not mine. Remember, he was reluctant. But at your word, I will let down the nets. So it was at Jesus' words that he lets down the net. The Bible says, but when Simon Peter saw it. Have you ever been in a place when you saw Jesus move in your life? Have you ever been in a place when he revealed your own heart? When you were exposed and you were uncovered and you didn't have anything between you and God. And it wasn't your doing, but you know it was all his doing. The place that says, I wouldn't have believed it if I hadn't seen it with my own eyes. The place that says, no way, Jose, or no way, Jesus, or no way, Jesus. It's my own heart that's being exposed here, and I'm seeing it. Have you ever been in that place? I'm going to tell you what that place is. That place is a place of brokenness before God. The place of astonishment is where Peter finds himself, and he knows that he is undone. Let me show you another place. Isaiah 6:1 says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon the throne, high and lifted up, and a train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face. With two he covered his feet. With two he flew. And one called to another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the foundations of the thresholds shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, Isaiah said, woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Like Isaiah, woe is me, Peter's, depart from me, describe the revelation of their hearts before a holy God. Luke 19, verses 1 through 10. And he entered Jericho and was passing through, and behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich, and he was seeking to see Jesus, who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not, because he was small in stature. So he ran on ahead of the crowd and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, which was above the crowd, for he was about to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today. So he hurried down and he received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they all grumbled. Who is they? The crowd. He was gone to be the guest of a man who is a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor. If I have defrauded anyone of anything, I restore it fourfold. And Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, since he is also a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. You see, in three different texts, we see God revealing himself to men, and each one of them moves from a place of conformity to a place of perfected by the love of God, and their eyes being opened to their own hearts. Throughout the Gospels, we see examples of separation that precede God's revelation. Throughout the Gospels, we see a separation so that God can have a personal revelation of his love. He is greater. His love is greater than the crowd. Because he wants to separate you. He wants to pull you out. He wants to bring you unto himself. And he wants to speak to your heart directly. See, Peter pushed out to the deep, away from the crowd. Zacchaeus, I'm coming to your house. Not their house, not a picnic outside, but I'm coming to your house, away from the crowd. Another example, the woman at the well. You boys run along and get lunch. I got to go over here in the middle of the day, away from the crowd, and I've got to deal with this woman's heart because I love her and I desire her to know me. It's greater. His love is greater than the noise. It's greater than your surroundings. It's greater than your problems. It's greater than your issues. It's greater than the things pressing in on you, and you feel lonely in the midst of the crowd. God is saying, I see you right where you are. Come out of that crowd and come to me. I want to speak to your heart. I want to show you how great my love is for you. I love you more than anything you can imagine. You've got to see Jesus for yourself. So you've got to be willing to be separated unto him. You've got to embrace separation. You've got to let go of some things in order to move forward, to let go of what no longer serves the purpose and the plans of God's purpose in your life. This is a quote from Van Moody. I messed it up. I'm going to say it again. You've got to embrace separation. You've got to let go of some things in order to move forward. Let go of what no longer serves the purposes and plans for God's purpose in your life in this season. God is trying to draw you out, and you've got to let go. You've got to be willing for God to say, my love is greater than what's going on around you in your life. John 17, 14 through 17 says, I've given them your word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world. Just as I am not of the world, I do not ask that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them in truth. Your word is truth. That word sanctify simply means to separate. Pastor Zach talked last week and he said some stats. 8% of church students believe sharing their faith is very important. That's only 8%. 92% don't even think that. 69% of churchgoers believe everyone will go to heaven. 74% seldom have a conversation with others about their faith. You know what these people are affected by? The crowd. We've been taught how to get saved. We've been taught how to believe. But we're very short on how to live. And those are examples in those statistics that show that. We're very short on how to love like Jesus loves. We would see those different numbers for sure if we were loving like Jesus loves. I'm thankful for the millions of dollars that the body of Christ raises and puts into missions and to church planning. Your millions will send people to the mission field. But will it keep them there? Your money will give them the resources to get there, but only the love of God will keep them there. Only the love of God will cause them to have testimonies in their heart and come back and minister from that place where they love beyond their capabilities because of his love. And others say, I want to have that kind of love, and I want to go to the missions as well. Amen? Our personal revelation of the love of God can't be substituted from someone else. But how we live out the love that has been revealed to us can attract those who want a revelation of Jesus for themselves. When you've had a real encounter with Jesus, you can't stop talking about him. You want to follow him. Amen? Why did Jesus attract prostitutes? Why did he attract the incurable, the sinner, the broken, the hurting, and the outcast? Because his love covers a multitude of sin. Because his love is greater than all of those things. The greatest part of this text is found here in Ephesians 3, and we'll finish on this. Pastor Zach read it at the beginning of the service today during the announcements, and it's this. Paul says, for this reason I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and in earth is named. This is Paul leading up to this in Ephesians 1, 2, and 3, talking about who we are in Christ. that the wall of partition has been taken down and there's no longer a wall of hostility between us, that we are one, that this is meant not just for the Jew, but for the Gentile also. So Paul is bringing it to a head right here, and he says, for this reason, I bow my knees. And here's the reason. From whom every family in heaven and earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend what, with all the saints, what is the breadth, the length, the height, and the depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with the fullness of God. Paul says that this is so important that he just doesn't pray. Because we can all pray. We can all stand praying. We can all drive praying. We can all lay in our bed praying. Amen? We can all go about our task praying. But he says, for this reason, I bow to my knees. This is important to me, is what Paul is saying. That I seek his face. That according to the riches of his glory, not just from his riches, but according to his riches that are insurmountable. See, the difference is that if you had two uncles named Bill and one was named Bill Gates and you needed $1 million, it depends on which uncle has the $1 million. If one uncle has 10 million, you might not get $1 million from that uncle. But if the other uncle has billions of dollars, it's just a drop in the bucket, right? Because it's according to his riches and glory. Amen? So we can go to a God who has unlimited resources. He wants to pour out on us. Let me finish by saying this. Are you sure? Are you certain? Are you unpersuaded that you are loved by God? Do you struggle with that? Believing that you are loved by God? Can I give you some symptoms of knowing that that is real in your life? When you feel insecure, that you don't have enough, so you go and you shop to try to fill that up, that emptiness up, and you don't have the money to spend, and you go in debt trying to satisfy that. When you spend all the time trying to be pretty, trying to be in shape, trying to look right for others, focus on your physical body, so that you can be accepted, so that you can be just one of the girls or one of the guys? Do you lie, cheat, and steal all for the sake of appearing to be one way and you know you're not that way? Some people call it hyperbole. Some people call it little white lies. Some people call it, oh, it's just, you know, I'm making up little stuff here and there just to get along the way. Do you do any of these things to try to make up for what you don't have? See, when you really know how much he loves you, you'll leave all that stuff. When you really know how much he loves you and your heart's exposed to him, money won't make up the difference. Sex won't make up the difference. Drugs won't make up the difference. A life of lasciviousness, lawlessness doesn't make up the difference. A life of trying to be good and perfect doesn't make up the difference. Only his love can move out all the insecurities in your life. Are you holding on to things? Are you being reluctant into moving into what God has told you that you've got to do? And you've been holding that out, holding out and holding out? God says you got to cross his line. Because he wants you. He wants your whole heart. The song says, the first line, that he is jealous for me. God is jealous for each and every one of you. And he wants nothing more than to reveal his heart to you today. To show you who he is. To reveal his heart to you, that when you see him for who he is, there will be nothing that will keep you from following. You stand to your feet. Bless you. Lord, you love us. Lord, you love us. Can we bring up Ephesians 3, that last part of that passage in verse 19 or 20? It says, now unto him. The next one. Oh, it's the one right before. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we could ask or think, according to the power at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. That is God's desire, is for his work in the inner man, not the outer surface things, but the inner man to be done in us. Father, we pray this morning that the Holy Spirit of God, from which only we can be moved, from which only we can be drawn into the things of God, Father, would be strengthened in us, that we may be granted, Father, to know your love, Father, to be able to receive and to walk in and to experience the love of God, so that we are able to share that love, so that we're able to love on others, so that we're able to walk as you walk, Father. So that Christ would be alive in us. And that we go after those and love like Jesus loved. Father, we give you all the praise and all the glory this morning. I pray that everyone under the sound of my voice, that you've touched their hearts and ministered to them, Father. Father, if they need prayer, I pray, Father, they would meet us at the altar and we would pray for them. There is something about the body of Christ, understanding the importance of being in agreement and sealing what God has ministered to your heart with brothers of faith, sisters of faith, praying with you and laying hands on you. Father, we give you all the praise and all the glory for it. In Jesus' name. And we all said, amen. God bless you. You are dismissed. If you need prayer this morning, we want to pray with you. We want to show God's love to you. We want to agree with you. Whatever the issue is in your life, in Jesus' name. God bless you. Have a great week.
He is jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree.